Adam Lambert, welcome.
Hi.
It's absolutely. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. It's good. Been a while since I last saw you.
Yes, yeah, 6 years, and my phone's beeping. I'm so sorry.
Who is it?
So rude.
That's
six
fine.
Years. Yeah,
I know. Totally. You've been traveling the world.
Yeah.
Living the dream.
Yeah, I am. I am.
Perfect.
Not sleeping, but getting to meet.
Oh, you look good for it, though.
Oh, thanks.
It's a good diet.
Smoke and mirrors.
There's a couple of things I want to talk to you about while you're in Absolute today, which is your latest album, because you're touring that as well, aren't you?
Woo-hoo.
And also the fact that we had the worldwide exclusive that Queen is headlining the Sunday night of the Isle of Wight Festival, which is huge news to us.
I am so excited.
Have you ever been to the Isle of Wight?
I have not, but I've heard of it for years. I mean, it's famous, you know.
Yeah.
It's got this amazing reputation back in the day, and then I know they took that break for many years.
Yeah.
Now they've brought it back, and it's going to be amazing.
So have any of the bands, have you talked to them about it, said, have you been to the Isle of Wight? You know, what's it like? Have you been to the festival before?
We haven't actually, since we've announced it, I haven't spoken to them. We've emailed a bit, but I'd love to pick their brain about what they know about it and their memories, if they've been or not. It's I looked at the lineup last year, just out of curiosity. I heard that we got the booking, and I was like, yay! And so I went online and looked at the lineup, and last year's lineup was incredible. And so diverse too, which I think is going to be really exciting. It's cool.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Kind of spans generations and genres.
Absolutely.
And all of it.
So what the punters do is they get a ferry across to go there. So what will you guys do? Will it be a helicopter?
Well, you know, the boys, they are royalty.
Of course.
The gentlemen of Queen. So I've quite enjoyed getting to tag along with them around the world, because they travel in style.
I bet they do. Was there any moment when you were traveling you thought, wow, this is pretty
Well, they
pretty
do.
Luxe.
They have a private jet. They use a jet. And when we went to, we did the Rock in Rio Festival a couple months back, and we had a helicopter from our hotel to the stage, which was pretty fancy.
How far was that?
It wasn't far, but the traffic, it was Brazil, and there's like traffic, and there's lots and lots of people. I mean, it was 85,000 people that we played to. So,
wow, amazing.
It's a bit of a traffic jam to get there, so we took the helicopter, which was crazy.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I was looking at some, I mean, last New Year's Eve, you were in London, weren't you, performing with Queen? It was such an amazing concert. I was watching some of that last night, and I was looking at how you performed, and I wondered if, when you got the gig, like singing with Queen, did you go back and watch all the videos of Freddie performing? Did you like pick up little nuances that he did and little tiny little phrasing? And did you study it that much?
I did do some studying. Yeah, I think that was, you know, I felt like I really needed to be able to get on stage and front the band. I had to do my homework, you know.
Yeah.
And I was pretty familiar with the band before that, but we when I first started working with them about 4 years ago, that's when I kind of went into the internet and just scoured everything and checked out live performances. Montreal was one that kind of stuck out to me. That, you know, it's the concert where he's running around in shorts with no shoes on. I just thought that was the funniest thing in the world.
Why don't you do it at the Isle of Wight?
I might. I like a shoe personally, but I have to say, like, watching him in that zone really made me understand him even more, because he just didn't give a You know, he was like, I'm going to do whatever I want in rock star fashion. You know, he really kind of, I don't know, I think he kind of defined what a rock star was to me. You know, when I started really getting into Queen when I was in my early 20s, I went, oh, that's rock and roll. He doesn't actually care.
Yeah.
He's so fabulous doing it.
And the performance with it as well is so theatrical, which was a word that really kind of bounced around in it when you did the first American Idol audition. It was like, it's a theatrical voice, isn't it? And I was thinking, there aren't many people that could take on that fronting Queen. Those songs are hard.
Yeah, they're big songs. Yeah, they are. And the other thing that, about their catalog that's really interesting is that it's kind of all over the place stylistically, you know?
Yeah.
Their early stuff was sort of progressive metal, and then they got into this like Baroque theatrical operetta stuff, and then they did funk, and then they have their southern kind of rock songs too, and big arena songs and pop songs, and it's crazy. It makes for a really fun night though, getting on stage with them, because you get a little of everything.
Yeah. And I was catching up with Roger actually at the Q Awards. He's such a gent, isn't he?
I love Roger. Yeah,
he's amazing. He's funny.
Pretty,
he liked my trousers, bless him. But he was saying that Bohemian Rhapsody, because it won the song for like Q's classic track.
Yeah.
And he said, it's such a pig to play live. I mean, there's so many time changes, key changes. I mean, it's
not
almost
simple.
Impossible.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
And when we're doing it on stage, you know, our show is completely live, 100%. You know, a lot of today's artists, and even when I do my solo stuff, you end up being on an electronic click track, they call it, which is sort of a metronome. And there might be a couple little elements from your record in there, little sounds and things, so that it sounds more like the original recording. But with Queen, they do it 100% legit, old school, no help, no electronics. Everything is real and organic, and it breathes.
Which is amazing,
except
actually.
Except for Bohemian Rhapsody.
Oh, really?
Because that middle section with all the voices and the choir and all that, it's impossible to do that live. So
you
that's
the
one
of
piece of pre-recorded material that they use in the show.
That's amazing.
Yeah. All that Mamma Mia, it's just... When they recorded that, apparently, there's layers of up to, 100 vocals.
Yeah, he was saying that,
himself,
yeah. So. And the tape was so thin by the end of it, because they were just, layering and layering.
Yeah,
but,
so you can hear, echoes from, the previous take, or, the other side of the tape. It's
yeah,
crazy.
Exactly. It's quite amazing, isn't
it?
Yeah,
it gives it a lot of character.
Have you got a favorite to perform?
I have a few favorites. I mean, I love Another One Bites the Dust. I just think that's such a sexy song.
Why?
It's aggressive. I love the bass line in it. I love how, sparse it is. Yeah. I think it's really cool. I love Somebody to Love. The lyrics in that song I can completely relate to. I understand that feeling. I'm single. Sometimes I look up and go, why? Who? Where? When?
There must be someone out there.
Gosh. I think there's a song called Save Me that I really connected to that we started doing kind of a little bit later. I love them all. I love I Want It All. I think that's a really cool song. It's really
so many,
aggressive. Yeah. I mean, they're all great.
Yeah. The Show Must Go On was struck me as quite a hard one to sing.
That one's a bitch, yeah. It's
a lot of high notes in that one.
It is high. It is very, very high. And it's the phrasing of the song is tricky. It's really tricky because it's very free form. Like Freddie, that was one of the things that he was so amazing at, is that he didn't always lock right into the drum beat. He kind of did what he wanted to and took his liberties with the rhythms and stuff.
Yeah.
So it's, when you're trying to learn one of his songs, sometimes I don't want to imitate him, but I have to do it that way because there's no other way to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. How do
absolutely.
You get all these words into that phrase? Yeah.
Yeah. Because it's kind of it must be a very difficult balance between sort of keeping it how Freddie wrote it, but also keeping it something to do with you as well, so it's your artistic.
Yeah, it's been a process of figuring out what that balance is. I didn't want to go too far away from it because that would feel kind of sacrilege to me, and also kind of cheat the fans of why they love the song in the first place.
Yeah, right.
But then if I got up there and did every single bit exactly like Freddie, that would also feel a bit cheap. So it was.
Yeah, it's difficult.
It's tricky. It's kind of second nature now because we've been on the road now for a while. But when we first started doing these full shows about 4 years ago, it was definitely kind of I would have to think and kind of really focus and reflect on it before we got into rehearsal and kind of come up with a plan and ask a lot of questions too.
Yeah. Yeah.
And luckily
of course.
I had, Brian and Roger right there. Yeah. So that helps.
Yeah, absolutely. I was actually going to say to you, if you could have asked Freddie anything, what would it have been? Because you were born 82, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What would I ask him? I mean, you want to go get a drink? I think that's what I would ask him. Yeah. I'd just want to sit down and kind of talk with him and just see what he was like. And, Brian and Roger have told me that they think that our senses of humor would have complemented each other. So that would be cool.
Yeah. They called you a gift from God, didn't they? Oh, I think in an interview. So
they are a gift. They are a gift to me because they have given me this amazing opportunity. And that's what's so great about it is I think it's a very symbiotic situation. We're both benefiting, all parties are benefiting and all parties are having a blast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did find it quite funny when I watched you singing Bohemian Rhapsody, in that audition. I was like, God, that's quite an amazing story.
Yeah.
I won't ponder it because you're probably so bored of talking about that, but
it is an amazing thing.
But
if someone had said to me walking the audition, oh, by the way,
in a few years from now.
Yeah. In 5 years, you will be on a world tour with this band. I would have been like, nah, you're joking.
Yeah.
I wouldn't believe it.
Amazing.
It's crazy.
Amazing. And now onto your material as well, because obviously you're so busy doing that as well, which must be so important for you to kind of get your stuff out there too, alongside it. It must be important for you as an artist.
It's actually really cool to be able to have both things going on sort of simultaneously, because they're totally different projects and they both kind of satisfy a different part of my artistry in a way. You know, I love the classics. I love the past. I love retro. I love, that's kind of where I, got my musical inspiration is sort of classic rock. And that's sort of how I came to prominence on Idol, is doing a lot of that catalog. And so when I get to be on stage with Queen, it sort of gives me that outlet and I get to be big and over the top and crazy and androgynous and camp and all of it. And then when I do this new project, my solo stuff, it's the opposite. It's a lot more down to earth. It's more intimate. It's very contemporary sounding. It borrows from the past here and there, but it's modern pop. And so I get to kind of look back with Queen and reminisce, and then with my stuff, I get to kind of look forward.
I was watching some of the videos of you performing in that. It's described as a dilapidated warehouse in East London, I think. Yeah. And you were saying, you know, it was quite important for the set to be like that when you were performing songs from the original High. Why? Why was that?
No, you know, I think in the past with my solo stuff, I've definitely gravitated towards very glam and polished and theatrical and stylized like looks and settings and the way we presented everything. But with this album, it's very real, the lyrical content. Mm. I mean, it definitely has like a glossy pop kind of sheen to it, but the songs are really singing about things that are kind of a little bit grittier, a little bit more complicated,
yeah,
and nuanced. And, you know, lyrics of a song like Ghost Town, which was the first single, I'm really trying to tell y'all something, you know, it's not always easy to go through life. It's not, you know, we all have these moments of doubt. We all have little existential crises, and we have times where we ask the big questions of like, why am I doing this? What am I? Who am I? What do I want? You know, and there are those brief moments where you feel numb because you can't figure it out or you've been let down by something.
Mm.
So the album, and it's not a completely depressing, heavy, gothic album either, but it's asking like difficult, confusing questions about life.
Mm. I think you were saying as well that along the same kind of lines, you know, sometimes you think you know what you want, don't you? When you get it, you're like, oh,
yeah,
kind of next. Are you a bit like that, always searching for the next thing?
Yeah, I'm sort of never satisfied. I'm a bit restless that way. But I think it's good to be an artist and kind of have that energy because it makes you push forward to the next thing. You know, and I love that all of these kind of deep, complicated ideas are all set to like great dance music too on this album, because it's sort of like is the best juxtaposition. I think that the beat and some of this kind of euphoric instrumentation can kind of be the medicine that maybe can help pull somebody through those moments in their life.
Well, New Order was like that, wasn't it? If you look at the lyrics, you know, it's really kind of thought-provoking lyrics with this huge kind of euphoric,
but you couldn't help but
soundscape.
Dance.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So you're going to be touring this. You've got a few dates in England, haven't you, in the UK?
Yeah.
And then you're taking it around the world?
Yeah,
you?
The original High tour, it starts on New Year's Eve in Singapore.
Nice. Lovely.
So I'm doing Asia, and then I go down to Australia and New Zealand.
Yeah.
There are going to be some dates somewhere in there in the USA, but we haven't announced them yet.
Okay.
Although I kind of have. And then, and then we're here in the UK and Europe.
Oh,
in
perfect.
April, so...
Lovely. And the show with Queen at the Isle of Wight, that's your only UK show next year.
Yeah. So everybody better come out and check it out. It's going to be a big
exactly.
one.
Exactly. Yeah. Do you always start, I've spoken to a lot of bands, they always start with a certain track, or they always have something in sort of song two of the set list, and they always have the same encore. Have you guys got that?
The set list has been really interesting. I mean, there's little changes and adjustments that we make, but when we put together the world tour, is that 2 years ago now? I guess it's almost 2 years ago. When we put that together, we sat down and really thought it out.
It's a lot of songs.
It's a lot of songs. They have too many hits.
Yeah, exactly.
I knew that this was the first time that I was going to be on stage with them in like this type of caliber, and you know, in front of Americans and then in front of UK audiences.
Yeah.
So I wanted to make sure we got it right, and they wanted to make sure we got it right. And I, in the back of my head, was definitely very... very focused on making sure the audience came along with me on that journey, because, you know, Freddie Mercury is singular and you can't replace him.
Yeah, the tough gig.
It's a tough gig. So I knew that sort of the way that we unfolded the songs and the set list was going to help or hurt the way that all got perceived. So, you know, there's a sense to why we do certain songs in certain sections of the show. And, you know, maybe I just think about things too hard, but...
No, I think it's really important. Yeah, I was just trying to sort of get out of you maybe what people can expect. It'll be a greatest hits kind of set, won't it?
Obviously. Yeah, of course. Yeah, and then there's some definite more B-side moments as well.
Okay.
And then sometimes we throw in something kind of... We change something up and we throw something into a section, but it's become a very nicely oiled set list. It works really, really well, and I think we've all kind of grown into it, and it feels... natural. It's in our bodies.
Oh, lovely. Yeah. How nice.
Yeah.
I'm so looking forward to it. I've never seen you before, so I'm really looking forward
to
it. We're all going to be there in force, I think, from Absolute. The final question, what happens just before you guys go on stage?
Well, I'm usually primping until the very last minute. You know, I've kind of like, I with my solo stuff, I've sort of like relaxed all that a bit. But I feel like when I get on stage with Queen, there's just a certain level of glam that has to exist for me.
Do you have to sort of feel quite charged when you go out there?
Charged, and I want to look and feel great. I want to give the audience this kind of pomp and circumstance that I think that the Queen catalog and the boys on stage, the gentlemen, I feel like they get a kick out of it too. When I come into the dressing room all glammed up, they're kind of like, oh, he's arrived.
Are you wearing that today?
Yeah, what does Roger always call me? The singest. Yeah. Because the singest. Yeah, I think, you know, a lot of the choices that I made with this concert, like song styling and like what I'm wearing and sort of how I act on stage, is all inspired by Freddie. It's all in my head. I always kind of think, like, would he enjoy watching this? Would he approve?
Yeah.
And so I have to pull out the fashion. Absolutely. The hair has to be nice and high. And
absolutely.
A little smoky eye for Freddie. Yeah.
Amazing. Well, we can't wait.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, and good luck with your tour as well.
Thank you.
There's loads happening. You're busy.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Oxford Street only does this once, okay?
No, just unlocking the door.
There's someone in the toilet.